yourself trapped in there now.
I'm afraid I do.
You just have to stay there.
Or are you sick?
I
wilderness. Our rector, Josh Stevens, is in Canada right now at his sister-in-law's wedding. And our deacon, Sandy, is spreading the good news of the risen Christ in the world and possibly fly fishing. So on behalf of all of our clergy and everyone at St. John in the Wilderness, welcome. We're very glad you're here. If you are new, if this is your first time or one of your first times coming and worshiping with us, we're really glad that you're here. In your pew, there's a welcome card that we'd love for you to fill out and place in the collection plate when that time comes, so that someone from our church can reach out to you this week, get to know you a little bit better, and tell you about all the wonderful things that we do at St. John. Speaking of which, the wonderful things that we do at St. John, we have formation classes in between our services, in between the 8:45 and 11 o'clock services. They are over at the parish complex across the street. We've got classes for elementary school children, as well as nursery, middle school and high school, and then adult formation as well. Today's going to be a little bit different because of our sparse staffing today. The middle and high school students are invited to either help with the younger kids or join us in adult formation today. Some other things that are going on. We've got a bazaar coming up in just a few weeks now, and we're still taking donations for that. So if you have things that you're looking to pass along to other people, we'd love for you to donate those things. The money that we raise from our bazaar goes to a great cause. I think they're taking donations on Saturday mornings over in the over there in the parish complex. Also, we have our Good News Gardeners is going to meet on Tuesday this week from 10 to 12 at the Garden of Canuga. This is a relatively new ministry that we have at St. John, and we invite anyone who'd like to come together and for a little bit of worship, a little bit of fun, and a way for us to get our hands dirty in God's creation for a good cause. The food that we're going to produce out of there is going to go to local food banks and people in need in the area. So join us for that. Speaking of formation, our youth program is reaching out to folks who might discern helping some of our younger members in various ways. So if I'd like for you to pray about this week or over the next coming weeks, if you feel called to either help with Sunday school class, with youth group, or with our Creation Care Camp, Wild Wonder in the summer, please contact the office, let me know, and we'll plug you in with our youth program. Let's see, and the last thing that I'm really excited to tell you about is that we've got a wonderful storyteller who's going to be in the parish hall this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Her name's Becky Stone. I've done some research on her, and she's just great. She tells stories from the perspectives of people like Harriet Tubman, and also an Episcopal priest, Polly Murray. So if you are interested in hearing a really unique and wonderful storyteller, this is part of our Friends of Music series. I'd invite you to come back out this afternoon. Any other announcements?
Let me just add to that. Becky is a singing actress, and she's very well known as a storyteller. She lives in Asheville. I've done some work with her over the last years, and I've never really seen her tell stories yet, but today's going to be a great, unique opportunity. She will be telling world folk tales. And she will sing some, and there might be some audience participation in that. She says, according to how much you're willing to do. I let her know that you all were very flexible and very happy to participate in everything. So I hope that you'll come out this afternoon at 4 o'clock and support Becky.
Thank you, Dwight. Any other announcements? Okay, please stand as you are able, and we will sing, "Oh, Praise Ye the Lord, Praise Him High." Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. The word of the Lord. Please read together those portions of Psalm 116 found in your bulletin. We will read responsively by whole verse. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray to you, save my life. I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants.
O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaidens. You have freed me from my bonds.
I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem, hallelujah. A reading from the first letter of Peter. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him, you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring Word of God. The Word of the Lord.
Who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days? He
asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The thing about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since those things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Doubt and disillusionment, discouragement and despair. These are emotions that are common to all of us at some point in our lives. Loss of a job, loss of mobility, loss of a loved one, divorce, illness, even the loss of a pet. Any of these things and more can throw us into a tailspin and fill our hearts with anxiety and fear. Sometimes we think that things will never be right again, especially in the middle of the night. Things seem at their very worst. We forget that there was ever a thing called hope, and all that we have learned about God's saving grace is nowhere to be found. If ever we knew how to call upon God, it is now only a distant memory from a better and happier time. And sometimes, even when we need God the most, we turn our backs on God and walk away. That is exactly the situation in which we find Cleopas and his friend in today's gospel. Followers of Jesus, they had believed in the new life he had promised them. Their hearts were filled with joy and anticipation as they looked forward to hearing more of his word and to being witnesses again and again to his good works, to his miracles. Fed in body, mind, and spirit by their fellowship with Jesus and with other believers, their lives had become filled with a new joy. And even all that they had to give up in order to follow him was nothing compared to what they now had. And they thought that it would go on forever. But that was then. Now all their hopes and dreams were as dead as Jesus. The events of the past few days, ending with the crucifixion and burial of Jesus, had torn every last shred of hope from them. They thought there was nothing left to do but to get out of Jerusalem and to go to another place, perhaps to try and pick up the pieces of their former lives and begin again. to turn their backs on all that had seemed so expectant and hopeful, and walk the 7 miles on the road to Emmaus. So they started out, the two of them, talking as they went, and going over the events they had witnessed, as if saying it one more time would change the outcome. Don't we all do that? If we've lost something, don't we keep revisiting the same spot, thinking that if we go there often enough, the lost item will miraculously appear? As Cleopas and his friend are walking and talking, a stranger meets them on the road. It is Jesus, but their hearts are so full of defeat and so devoid of faith that they do not recognize him. What's more, when the stranger asks what they're talking about, they cannot believe that he doesn't know all that has happened. Where has he been? And so they tell it all once more. They even tell him about the empty tomb, how some women had seen a vision of angels who said that Jesus was not dead, but alive. But still, they said to the stranger, no one had seen him, so perhaps the women had just heard what they wanted to hear. When they had finished their side of the story, the stranger scolded them. Weren't you listening when he told you how all of this must come to pass? Don't you know how, from the beginning of time, the prophets had foretold exactly what has just happened, that the Messiah must suffer before he enters his glory? As he recites scripture to them, going all the way back to the time of Moses, they are so taken in by his words that when they reach Emmaus, they don't want to let him go. They want to hear more, and so they invite him to stay with them. He agrees, and as they sit down to supper, the strangest thing happens. A guest in someone else's home, Jesus becomes the host. He picks up the bread, he blesses it, he breaks it, and he gives it to them. And in that simple but so meaningful act, something they had seen him do time and time again, their eyes were opened. And they know with certainty not only who he is, not only that this is indeed Jesus, but they also know that all he had said to them was true. It was just like Mary in the tomb. Jesus had only to speak her name, to call out to her in the same way he always did, with the same familiar voice and inflection, and she knew immediately who he was. For Cleopas and his friend, their doubt and despair were instantly forgotten. They were so renewed in faith, so excited and happy that their feet grew wings, and they ran all the way back to Jerusalem to tell the others the good news. Now, if Jesus was disappointed in the disciples and all the others who deserted him at the end, who in the midst of their despair and disillusionment chose to take the road to Emmaus rather than stick it out by his side, we never hear about it. One of the most wonderful things to come out of the resurrection is that we learn this about Jesus. No matter how bad things become for us, no matter where we go to hide ourselves when the world gets to be too much for us, and even if we lose our faith for a time, he will come to be with us. He won't ask us for explanations. We won't have to justify our position, and there will be no indictment. He will simply meet us as we walk, each of us along our own road to Emmaus. It may be on a field or a court after losing the big game on the final play, or it may be in a car that is taking us away from those things that we can no longer endure. Or it may actually be on a road as we try to walk off the results of that recent medical test that took us completely by surprise. Whatever route we take, when we just can't take it anymore, Jesus will meet us there. Even though it is us who are going away, he is always faithful. In the words of the noted preacher Barbara Brown Taylor, he comes to the disappointed, the doubtful, the disconsolate. He comes to those who do not know their Bibles, who do not recognize him even when they are walking beside him. He comes to those who have given up and are headed back home, which makes this whole story about the blessedness of being broken. This should not surprise us. Jesus' entire ministry was centered on those who needed him the most, the poor, the sick, the blind. Wherever he could find them, he shared not only his love, but whatever else he had, until finally he shared his broken body as well. The wonderful truth of this story is that God uses everybody to proclaim God's kingdom. And not only when we are being good and faithful and true, but even in our moments of waywardness and faithlessness as well. Just as he made himself known to the two men walking along the road, and then used them to make his story and the news of his resurrection known to the world, so he comes and stands beside us in our moments of despair, calling our name, waiting for us to recognize him, to realize again the truths of his words, to be renewed in faith so that he can use us again. In countless ways, Jesus comes among us, never demanding, but patiently waiting for us to open our eyes and see him. It may happen as we stretch forth our hands in prayer. It may happen in the reading of scripture or in listening to a friend. It may come as we walk along the road, or like Cleopas and his friend, it may be in the breaking of the bread. But he is there. We have only to be willing to have our eyes opened in faith so that we can see the risen Christ for ourselves, so that we can feel his presence and his peace as they surround us. The gift of Emmaus awaits you. Wherever you are on that road, pray that when the risen Lord comes to you, your eyes may be opened so you can behold him in all his glory. And then, renewed in faith, run to tell others the good news.
We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and was crucified. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
Peace, Lee. Thank you. Thank you. Peace, Kathy.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. Father, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing.
Redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and
and preserve it in peace. Remember Jose, our bishop, Michael, our presiding bishop, Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, and all who minister in your church. Remember all your people and those who seek your truth. Remember Jan, Joyce, Philip, Virginia, Jasmine, Loretta, Renee, Sean, Joanne, Dottie, Tom and Anna, Jean, John, Lori, Charles, Mary, Rosalind, Bob, Christopher, Virginia, Kristen, Emily, Gerald, Betsy, Jared, Stacy, and those we name now in our hearts or aloud. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ, especially Robert Hayden, and those whose faith is known to you alone. Bring them into the place of eternal joy and light, and grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, who with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with St. John and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past, we praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
With whom will you share this communion?
Sumac.
In the name of this congregation, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood.
We who are many are one body, because we share one bread and one cup.
Let us pray. Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and sacraments of our blood. Send us now to the world of Jesus, and grant us strength and courage to love our hearts that are with you, the balance and singleness of our heart, through Christ our Lord.
Christ, the Good Shepherd, who laid down his life for the sheep, draw you and all who hear his voice to be one flock within one fold. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always.
Amen.